It's a great pleasure to have a chance to meet someone I first met probably 40, 50 years ago, Christopher Ricks. Christopher, I always start by asking where and when a person was born.
I was born in Beckenham, Kent on September the 18th, 1933, a day of birth which I now know I share with Dr. Johnson, as I've known for some time, with Greta Garbo, which was revealed to me more recently, and very recently with Batman. I didn't know that Batman had a birthday, but somebody shows with it in one of the films. It's his birthday, on September the 18th.
Well, better company could not be chosen. Would you like to tell me something about your ancestors, or as far back as you like to go? Many people go back to their grandparents or great-grandparents.
I know nothing about my great-grandparents, nothing at all. My grandparents, both of my grandfathers were dead before I was born. My maternal grandfather was in the fur trade and was French, with behind that Polish, though I haven't ever seen a family tree that takes me much behind that. So my mother's maiden name was Gabrielle Valentine Ernestine Leontine Rozak, Rozak being the Polish bit. The two of those names were in the expectation of a bequest, perhaps, or a gift from Uncles Ernest and Leon, neither of whom came up with anything. So she dropped those names and became Gabrielle Valentine Rozak, and then Ricks. My children amiably thought of it as Vaseline, thinking of names that they could have for my mother, who was a very lovable person. My father's
Fur trade was in Canada? Or?
No, I think it was in France, and then came, I know almost nothing. The divorce in the family, the divorce of my father from my mother, or the other way around, whichever way it was, happened, I think, when I was about three. I remember nothing from before the war. The war was exactly when I was six. I can't remember anything from before the war. But the family rifts meant that there wasn't much talk about families further back. My father's father was also in the rag trade, that is, women's coats and suits wholesale in London. So it may very well be that my mother met my father in that sort of something like professional world. I can't remember my father and mother together. Both my father and my mother remarried. But I can hardly go behind that except for a painter, James Ricks, who exhibited sometimes at the Royal Academy, though he was not an academician. I would like to be able to have seven of his paintings to leave to my seven children. I have four paintings of his. One of himself, looking, I think, rather more amiable than he's somehow likely to have been, and wearing a skull cap, misinterpreted by colleagues of mine in America as establishing him as Jewish, but it is not, that's not what it is. I like his paintings, and they go for quite a lot of money, actually, now, but I have the fantasy that it would be nice to be able to leave one of those to each of my children. And he lived in Somerset. His son, in Walter Ricks, my grandfather, as it were, married my grandmother, who was from Scotland and was a Bruce. So all the boys had the middle name Bruce. So my father was James Bruce Ricks. My uncles were Rafe Bruce Ricks and Donald Bruce Ricks. And I kept that going with my sons by my first marriage. So David Bruce Ricks and William Bruce Ricks exist, but in the second marriage, for some reason, I thought it wasn't altogether just to appropriate so many of the names.
When you mention the rag trade, that is associated with Jews often, but it wasn't.
It wasn't, no, it was, there was more than a vein of anti-Semitism on my father's side, and there would be real disagreements about how heinous that was. I mean, I think it's deplorable. It was It was sort of impersonal. It went with a perfectly honest expression that some of one's best friends were Jews and so on. But it was odious, I think, rather than heinous. But there is a point of view which says, no, anti-Semitism is gangrenous. Mm-hmm. And that means that unless it's extirpated, you will die of it. Mm-hmm. I remember that the pubs in London, even after the war, the Cock Tavern near where Dad worked off Oxford Street, still had anti-Semitic cartoons on the walls, though it also had anti-Welsh and anti-Scottish and anti-Irish. But I never liked any of that, but I probably toyed with it at my grammar school.
Mm. Well, going down to your parents' generations, what did your father do and your mother?
My father went into his father's business. That is, Walter, my grandfather, died in his 40s. Mm. Almost the only bit of family memorabilia that I have is an obituary from the Draper's Record when he died, and I'm going to guess at when that, I don't know when that was. I honestly don't know, but let's say it might have been 1920, 25, something like that. And he was clearly respected within the trade. So it was wholesale women's coats and suits. Mm. My father went into that, but my father didn't like work, and he had cocooned himself against various unhappinesses that had befallen him. His father died before, as he himself said, before he ever got to know his father. Back then, let's say Edwardian England, you didn't know your father when you were a child, you grew to know your father later. So his father died without, I think, my father ever really knowing him, though I think he loved him. One of his brothers, Donald, after whom my brother was named in due course, was killed on a motorbike when young. My father himself got tuberculosis in his late teens, I think, though I don't have any real sense of family history, and he married my mother, so this was a string of unhappinesses befalling him and so on. He clearly went off my mother rather quickly, and her being French was not an advantage. She was very good looking, I thought, and I remember her as a rather lovely photos of her when she was young. So Dad did that. Except that he didn't like working at all. So he would go to work and he would open a tin of chocolate digestive biscuits and he would eat those and he would do the Times crossword puzzle and he'd go out for a non-working lunch for a long time and so on. The firm had been started by a man called Callender and a man called Davis and a man called Ricks, my grandfather. So he came up with the extremely cumbrous, compacted name Cal Darrick. Clearly a bad move. Callender was successful, and Callender's son was powerful, perhaps not always entirely scrupulous. Davis sort of disappeared at some point from it, so it was Callender's son and Rix's son who were to run it. And Callender worked, and therefore controlled much more. And they made coats, unfortunately, that were built to last forever and so on. The whole idea, these coats, but it was a moment when we were deciding, perhaps men too, that they didn't want coats that would last forever. You wanted a coat, please, that you had a good reason for getting rid of after a year or two and so on. So that the very thing which had been their strong selling point when fashion was not very powerful did for them. So Dad presided over the gradual dissolution of what had been a successful business, which I think left quite a lot of money. I mean, I used to hear a figure like £40,000 a long time ago, which was then in railways, apparently, in South American railways, which must have seemed a good buy at the time. My grandmother lived into her 90s. My father's mother lived into her 90s and was Scottish and wore a kilt and had great dignity. She outlived all her three sons, which was a tragedy for her, because Donald had died in his teens. Mm. My uncle Rafe, who escaped, had the military cross and escaped from a prisoner of war camp during the war, but ran to seed and died youngish by present day standards. And she outlived all three of them into her 90s. So my father was in the firm. From very early on, Donald and I had been allocated, though not formally custodially, to a parent. I was clearly my mother's child, and Donald was my father's child. Donald and I got on perfectly well, and we were at the same boarding school.
In the sense that they liked, you liked
it. Yes, that would be, yes.
Not biologically.
Yeah, no, that's right. In the sense that it was thought that Donald would become a businessman, and there was a business into which he could go. It was thought that I was some sort of precocious, brainy little boy and so on, and that there wasn't any talk of academic life. Nobody had been at a university or anything like that. But there was some sort of feeling, so as it were, my mother looked after my interest by giving me, when I was a schoolboy, a subscription to the Times Literary Supplement and so on. And my father looked after my brother by teaching him how to handle chisels, things like that. So then Donald loved doing things about the house. So that's my so my father's world was a business world to which he did not dedicate himself, and my brother in due course joined the firm hoping to protect it against our father. Fortunately, it folded after only a few more years. It was not protectable. So Donald escaped. He wouldn't, I think, have been able honourably to leave it. But fortunately, it went bankrupt after whatever he did. So he then moved into the Burton Group and had a perfectly successful business career still in the world of women's coats and suits, and retired at 60, or just before 60. From when he was 30, he counted down exactly how long he had to go. He would say, only 28 years, 3 months, 1 week and 2 days to go until I retire. And then just before 60, his patience snapped. And he left England and went to Scotland with his wife and fished enormously. My mother, what did she do?
Yes.
She did every kind of job to earn a little bit of money. She must have had alimony. She must have had alimony, but it probably wasn't much. My Scottish grandmother was quite generous to her. My French grandmother, who lived with her son, my uncle Jean, until Jean died. Jean was sort of forbidden to marriage. It was understood he wouldn't ever marry, and he would be in love. There was no way of his relinquishing his duties to my grandmother.
This was in France, was it?
No, that was in England. No, they had moved. I think my mother probably came to England when she was a child of 8 or 10 or 12 or something like that. And she didn't sound French, except that she preferred, perhaps with a slight affectation, to call cinemas the Odeon, the Gaumont, instead of the Gaumont and the Odeon. So there was no money on either side, but there was a kind of there was a shabby gentility on my father's side. He had been at a minor public school, Framlingham. I was at a grammar school from when I was 8 to when I was 18.
Right, and you may not want to answer, but how do you think their characters may have influenced you?
Well, I do too much work. I'm not sure about the holic bit of it, but I do work too much, I don't know whether that's I don't know what relation that has to my being an irritable person, and I'm not exactly impatient, but I'm not good at relaxing. I don't like holidays. I love going to places if I have some reason other than enjoying myself to be there. So speaking of the Chinese university, which we were speaking of before in Beijing, I liked going there because I was going to give 3 talks, and I was there for 4 days and I gave 3 talks and then it was worth it. So I think I've been determined not to be my father, insofar as one determines these things. There's a wonderful moment that William Empson said about King Lear. One moment Empson writes, at this moment, Lear decides not to go mad. And it's quite wonderful, and I think he's right, that is something that happens in the play, and you can't go on deciding not to go mad. But it's like deciding to get out of a nightmare. There's a moment in the nightmare when you say, actually, I'm not going to do this anymore, it's a nightmare. And I can't always do it, but I can do it sometimes. So I think my father's very amiable fecklessness, he lived for games. He was happy playing Mahjong, or he wasn't really, bridge would have required too much of him, but chess and draughts and shove halfpenny and billiards and snooker and golf, that would be, and the crossword puzzle, this was it. I've I'm not good at any of those ways of relaxing, if that's what they are.
Mm.
My mother had great sweetness of disposition. I wish I had a sweeter disposition as she had. She was never unkind.
Mm.
My stepmother was often unkind.
So your father remarried?
My father yes, my father left my mother for my stepmother.
Mm.
I wasn't told that, but if you look at the timing of it, that's clearly what it was.
And you were about how old? You were three?
I think I was three, something like that. My brother Donald was 4 years older than I am. I remember nothing back then because I remember being told things.
Mm.
For instance, that when Donald was born, that my mother came round from whatever the equivalent of pethidine was back then and said, is he all right?
Mm.
And the midwife said, he doesn't have all his fingers on one hand. And my mother gulped, and the midwife said, but then he looked very funny with all his fingers on one hand. you're no longer allowed to be a midwife and make remarks of that kind. But it was kind of wonderful. And I remember when I heard it, let's say when I was six or eight or whatever it would be, and I thought, isn't the English language wonderful? Isn't it fiction? How wonderful that those words.
Mm-hmm.
What is this? I never said Gestalt, but what against what background is it assumed that somebody is saying he doesn't all have all his fingers on one hand? I was very good for interpreting poems and so on. So yes, my
stepmother.
My stepmother. Her name was Grace Skelton. She was called Gay. She was brisk and curt, and had a hard life because Dad never did anything about the house at all. It was partly that people back then didn't do anything. He never did. She cleaned his shoes. She made his lunch. She saw him off to work. She didn't work. My mother had odd jobs. For instance, she worked on a farm in Berkshire for a while. In the war, she worked in a munitions factory and one night made more sprockets than anybody else or something like that. There were things of that kind. They both smoked much, much, much too much.
She was a bit unkind, you said as well.
My stepmother was very severe. I was very frightened of her. I'm not.
You lived with them. You lived with your father.
No. Well, you see, from 8 to 18, I was at a boarding school. Uh-huh. So, and I, if I say I don't remember anything before the war, what I mean is I can't remember street lights, for instance. That after the war, it was astonishing. I remember nothing other than blackout. I remember bombs falling in Beckenham, Kent, in I suppose 1940. Was evacuated down to Cornwall, where I still have the Bible that was given me by the family with whom my brother and I lived. Then in 42, early in 42, I suppose I was then 8 and a half, that would be right, went to King Alfred's School, Wantage, where I stayed till I was 18. My brother joined a little bit later and protected me against being beaten to a pulp. It was important not to be too protective of a younger brother because that would get them differently beaten up and hurt. But it was certainly a help to me that he was in the same school. I was frightened of my stepmother. She was a severe person. A possible explanation of her severities, even though apart from those of the very difficult task of living with Dad, who didn't have much money and urinated it all after going to the pub. So it was he didn't live at home, basically lived as far as possible in the pub. And was much loved in the pub and had that ability to get on with everybody that you have if you're a certain kind of gentleman. He was a rogue gentleman. And he was very, very nice. People who couldn't read in the pub, he'd read their letters to them. People who couldn't write in the pub, he'd write a letter for them. He got on very well with people in a way that's supposed to be the mark of a gentleman. He was, of course, a conservative. My stepmother said on one occasion, I suppose I was 20, if I thought that you would vote Labour, I would smack your bottom, she said. It's a little bit late for putting me over and smacking my bottom. Sort of thing.
Okay, well, let's go to your grammar school. I mean,
yeah.
I thought grammar schools were day schools mostly, but this, you were a boarder.
Yes, King Alfred School, Wantage had about 50 boarders and about 100, or after a while perhaps 150 day boys, or day bugs, as we affectionately called them.
Yes.
So it drew on Swindon, Didcot. It was Wantage, of course, in those days. It was before Maud did one of his egregious follies and abolished the county lines and all that. So it was, of course, in Berkshire. The idea that King Alfred was born in Oxfordshire is clearly ridiculous. So it was that or Newbury. We were looking for somewhere that wasn't going to be bombed, that wasn't very expensive. It was a direct grant school. So my parents put up a little, my Scottish grandmother put up a little bit of money, I think, and that, but I must have had a scholarship there. And I got a good education. I was very frightened, and of course boys, prefects beat boys back then, and masters beat boys. And
were you beaten?
Oh, very much. Well, not very much so, because I was, of course, pusillanimous and acquiescent and servile. But apart from, yeah, everybody got beaten sometime. I don't think it doesn't seem to me to have done me any great harm. I'm not in favour of it. I'm very against it. But it, I can't think of any interesting traumatization. I don't seem to have any.
What about hazing when you first went? Did you have
that? No, we didn't have that. I went into the house that wasn't part of the main school. There was still gaslight. There was a matron. It was rather Dickensian, or it was more like the Joan Aiken books, like The Wolves of Willoughby Chase. It wasn't really 19th century. It was sort of 20th century Victorianizing and so on. And there was a white Russian who lived across the road, things of that kind. Wantage was fine. You weren't allowed into town except on a Saturday morning. You weren't allowed to have much pocket money, which was a good idea. You wore, of course, a school uniform. I think we were well taught. The two English masters were very good. Mr. Swan and Mr. Harrison were very good and very different. Mr. Swan had been educated at Cambridge and believed in Dr. Leavis. So then I'm 14 or 15, wanted us to read Eliot and Joyce and Lawrence, as well as other things. Mr. Harrison was old-fashioned and believed that Milton was a very great poet. I think they liked one another, and they certainly showed that it was possible amiably to argue or to differ. So I was asked to write something for the Sunday Times, I don't know, what feels like 10 years ago, so it's probably 20 years ago, and I wrote about Mr. Swan and Mr. Harrison, and word came from Australia, where Mr. Harrison was living out of retirement, he was in his 70s or 80s, or whatever, 80s I suppose, whatever it would be. Teaching was fine. I protected myself, as at the beginning of Jane Eyre, by being bookish, and as at the beginning of Jane Eyre, it doesn't really protect you because they throw the book at you and hit your head. But it was something, and with minor snobberies. I had a golf club and a few golf balls, and I would go out onto the playing field and I would hit this golf ball about, and it distinguished me from ploughboys. That was my feeling about it.
Were you short-sighted?
You're asking whether I touched my body as a child?
No. I'm asking, bookishness and short-sightedness and scholarship often go together.
Yes.
And you're wearing glasses for myopia.
Yes.
When did you become short-sighted?
Well, I didn't know that I needed glasses, I think, till I was about 27.
Ah.
It seems quite late, but I knew. Donald wore glasses from early on, but I didn't wear them. And my oldest child, David, who's now 54, he realised when he was young he needed glasses, and he would set off for Bristol Grammar School, put the glasses in his pocket and see out the day at school and so on. But I had a weak sight, clearly. But
it also affects games playing, and I wonder.
Yeah, fair. I was afraid of the cricket ball. I'm wanting you to be getting at something, of course. If that's what you're getting at, sir. I was afraid of the cricket ball. It seemed to be immensely too hard. I didn't like the football either. I didn't like games. I played hockey.
That fits with short-sightedness, because you couldn't see them coming enough.
I couldn't see them going well, but I wasn't bad at hockey. Nobody likes being left wing, so I was able to be left wing, a position from which I was ousted by the only person from school that I still have kept in touch with, a man called John Barnard, a very, very good scholar of Augustan literature and an editor of Keats, and a very, very nice person. And he's the only person from Wantage that I know, but it took me a few years to get over the fact that he had ousted me from the team. But no, I never had gay. I did fencing because I didn't want to be punched in the face with a boxing glove. And
did you have any hobbies at school? Did you collect things or...?
No.
Yeah.
I don't really think so. I might have had a stamp album into which I quickly ceased to want to put stamps. I read a lot. There was a brief moment when I was terrible at drawing. I was bottom of the class in drawing, any kind of art. I wasn't any good at any kind of woodwork, anything like that. Donald again was blithely being the opposite, and so on. I don't think I had any hobbies.
Just reading. Music?
Yeah.
You didn't play an instrument or anything?
My mother wanted me to learn the piano.
Yeah.
I didn't want to learn the piano and I never practiced. And it was the period of my life in which I had most persistently to make up scarcely credible lies or tarradiddles or fibs about why I hadn't been able to practice. It didn't quite reach the point of my claiming that I was having my period, but it was quite... I was terrified of my blind piano teacher, who could, of course, tell whether I was lying from my voice.
Mm.
I begged my mother not to waste her money on these lessons, but it was very important to her. Perhaps vicariously, she wanted to live out as parents tend to, that what one hadn't done oneself. She would have liked to play the piano, she wanted to. So the song of the Volga boatman, yo heave ho, I could just about muster. And I was so good. I liked singing. I wasn't good at it, but I liked it a lot. Handel's Messiah was a pleasure to sing. Not much there, really.
What about music since then? Has it been important to you?
Listening to it is important to me. I thought I would sing in a choir when I got to Oxford, and I did a bit at first, probably the Balliol Choir, though I don't remember quite what it was. But I didn't. I found myself short of time. I mean, these are excuses, but they can also be reasons. I needed the time at Oxford to whatever it would be, to get on with work and so on. So I didn't. My father loved classical music. He had a small but rather good collection of records. He had a huge old gramophone with a great, great golden horn. This huge thing. We were not to touch it. It was like there was some. It was not, of course, actually phallic in shape, but it was. But father's horn was this huge thing on top of a great square cabinet, with a sort of cigar clipper to clip the fibre needles, and we were never to touch it. And you could see his moving into dismay and then sort of kind of despair and everything when he ceased to listen to classical music, because he had loved listening to it. He liked minor composers best. It was clear to him that Peter Warlock was underrated. It was clear to him that Delius was easily the match of those foreign people. it was good. But we weren't allowed to put it on, and once he didn't put it on, it wasn't there any longer. Radio was important. Listening in the darkened dormitory, if one were allowed to Valentine Dial, reading some dark story and so on, that was all good. We weren't allowed into the cinema, of course. Had lots of homework, that was all right. Was taught by J.M. Cohen, the editor of Penguin Classics. I mean, one of the great honourable popularisers, translator, of course, of Montaigne and of Rabelais, and of many, many great Penguin enterprises. He was, as he said on the jacket of one of his Penguin books, jerked into schoolmastering by the Blitz. So he lived out his time at Wantage. And then, after the war, went back into the publishing world. He left a report on my brother. he had to leave a report when he left the school on each of the forms, and the fifth form, which I suppose Donald was in then, the entire report consisted of the words, "Only Ricks is hopeless." And I loved regaling Donald with that to the end of his days. "Only Ricks is hopeless." I was like, good. Kind of witty. I liked Cohen. I don't remember him very well, but he was a force for good.
Returning to music, I mean, do you now listen to classical music?
I do. I listen especially to Haydn. I remember my astonishment when about 30 years ago, we were talking about favourite composer, and somebody whom I didn't know said that Haydn was the greatest composer, and so on. And I sort of docketed it, and so on. I think Haydn makes me happier than anybody, any other musician. I don't mean he's deeper. But I love it. And I do listen a lot.
And do you get inspiration for your work in any way? Some writers.
But I'm not really a writer. It's very nice of you to say. I'm only a literary critic and sometimes a literary historian and an editor. I have no creative abilities at all.
We'll come back to that.
I like it if people remonstrate for a moment and say, come, my dear fellow. But pretty quickly, then they...
I don't think it's binary. I mean...
No, I agree about that.
It's on a continuum. You're towards the end of the analytical rather than the creative. But there, you know, every bit of our lives is filled with creativity in certain ways. So even a comment on Keats or something is going to have an element of creativity in it.
Well, there is something... Yes, I wouldn't deny... But do you want to defer that to...
Finish it.
I wouldn't deny that there's something creative and imaginative about an immense number of things. That is, there are imaginative editorial decisions. That is, to see that this needs to be amended in the Hausmann manner, and the emendation is such and such. That is creative. But I think the idea of... I think there is, for me... There is a huge difference between what Paradise Lost is and what any book about Paradise Lost is. Now, in philosophy, that's not the case. That is, any philosophy is philosophy. And that if I turn towards Bernard Williams, he is doing the same kind of thing as Aristotle, or whoever the philosopher be, if it's ethics, etc. So there is a simple continuum there. They're all philosophers. Whereas for me, what happened in literary criticism, as you're aware, is that the word discourse arrived in order to try to abolish. We're all engaged in a discourse. Mill was engaged in a discourse. I'm engaged in a discourse. And I think that was very bad for literary criticism. That what I do is a second order activity. It's a service industry. It's a service well worth rendering, and I, you know, on the whole, I think I do render a service to Keats, but I'm rendering a service to him. We're not both engaged in discourse, but
yes, let's come back to it because it's so important. Were you confirmed?
Yes, I was confirmed at the ordinary age, and I pretended that I sufficiently believed, but that was the end of it. Confirmation, the little voice said, come off it. I realized I didn't believe in it.
Your parents were neither of them?
Well, Dad had the irrationality of an angry atheist. I mean, in Beckett it would be the bastard, he doesn't exist. So there was an Irish bull element there. I mean, Dad had a Hardy-esque view that if there was a God, he had killed Dad's father, he'd killed Dad's brother, he'd given Dad tuberculosis, and he'd sent my mother Dad's way. So Dad sort of seethed against the Christian God, basically wasn't interested other than to expostulate and so on. He didn't have a position. He had a deep vexation. My mother, in some vague, in a characteristically amiable way, would have liked to think there was something in it. She must have been brought up, I suppose, as a Catholic, because it didn't seem to be a Huguenot family. She never went to church. I, of course, went to chapel and church in Wantage all the time. And Wantage was very Wantage was a very religious place. It teemed with nuns. The rival to us, except that we were not really their rival, because they were grand, was a school called St. Mary's, mm-hmm. where they played lacrosse and they raised their lacrosse instruments and said, rah, 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 and so on, and we weren't allowed even to look towards them. Mm-hmm. So it felt a very priest-ridden, black caterpillar place.
But for the rest of your life, is there a God-shaped hole or nothing?
Well, there isn't a hole. Let me think about it. I never believed what was said in the sermons. Like a lot of people, I liked the music. Mm. I loved the King James Bible and the Book of Common Prayer. Wonderfully well written, and so I didn't mind taking part in all that. There wasn't much a question really whether one would take part in it, except by a kind of exhibitionist intransigence, which I didn't fancy. Mm. The bishops were either too fat or too thin. I mean, there was a corporeal thing. Why do bishops have to be either kind of haggard and ascetic and self-punishing, or with good capon lined? I mean, why were they all like that? And they all came and they gave terrible sermons telling you that the cross is I crossed out. Oh, great, thank you very much. I mean, I've read George Herbert. Could you not treat us a bit better than that? And so on. So I didn't believe any of it. I thought it was I thought the case that was being made for it by... I loved Empson fairly early, though probably I didn't read him until I was in the army. I remember being astonished that in the barrack room somebody was reading Seven Types of Ambiguity. Very bold thing to do, I imagine, in a barrack room doing national service. I thought, this guy is really going to get beaten up. And Empson's anti-Christian crusade has always felt very true to me, and Shelley's remarks and so on. And I love Milton, but Milton was my favourite reading at school, partly out of snobbery. But it is, you know, it is the greatest sort of science fiction book in the language, and it's very, very thrilling. And C.S. Lewis's attempts to make sense of a plurality of inhabited worlds did fascinate. I mean, I suppose I was at school when I read Perelandra, Out of the Silent Planet, and so on, and Screwtape Letters, and thought them very valiant, but terrifically unconvincing. They were clearly what the religion was up against, that you'd have to have a Christ on every planet. And no amount of calling your character Ransom made it altogether plausible and so on. So no, my oldest child is a Christian. So that was not a horrid shock, but it was a big surprise a few years ago. He's now 54. This is probably it's probably now 8. I double everything now, and I will soon have to triple things. But he and his wife Katie, living in the head's house of the school, Seven Oaks School, of which she is the head. So they bought a place in the country with the money that they had from their previous house. I said to David, has the vicar called on you? And David, with splendid straight-facedness, said, no, but since the subject has come up, I should perhaps let you know that I've been received into the Church of England. Now, judge of my astonishment, I'd given him a healthy upbringing. I didn't know what to say. Well, actually, I immediately extended my hand and shook him by the hand. That seemed to be the right thing to do.
Well, you're not a militant, like your father, or Dawkins. You're not a militant anti...
Well, I'm not... I think that Empson is right, and that it is a loathsome system of torture worship. But that's rather, that is, whether there is a God or not is different from whether the Christian God is the blackest thing ever invented by the heart of man, which is sort of Empson's view. Alone of the great religions, it declined to abolish human sacrifice. If you're a believer, you say alone of the great religions, it successfully abolished human sacrifice. By having a human sacrifice that was not solely human, and there was once and for all, and so on. So that's the argument. But the doctrine of the Trinity seems to me pernicious in the ways in which Empson believes it to be pernicious. And it's theologically terrifically unschooled, and my friends who are Catholics roll their eyes at my naivety and ignorance, and I don't doubt reasonably. But you need the Trinity, because if God is identical with the Son, it is masochism. And if he's not in any way identical with the Son, it's sadism. So what you have, that is the root...
Why do you need the Holy Ghost?
Well, the Holy Ghost, I mean, I think the Holy Ghost is going to condemn the other two to eternal torment. He's had a very, he's been very badly treated, and not, or she, and not just for the last few centuries. I mean, that is, nobody's ever been able to make, I will be told that Dante has made the Holy Ghost, has realized the ghost. But on the whole, the religion has been a father and son. It's gone binary in practice, however triangulated it meant to be. I haven't sufficiently put Milton adduces the Holy Ghost, of course, very beautifully, but very, very briefly only. Dove-like sat brooding on the great abyss and made it pregnant. Even that, with the odd feeling that how could you sit brooding if it was only now that you were making it pregnant? So the sort of feeling of these immense paradoxes. But I'm not one of those people who says I wish I could believe it were true. I will not like the prospect of dying, though the prospect of living forever, rationally considered, is immensely worse. Irrespective of whether it's torment, it would be torment to live forever in heaven, so far as anybody can conceive. But these are naivetes, but I meet a lot of people who say, if only I could believe. I'm glad I don't believe it. I think it's pernicious, but I don't argue with David about it, for whom the music was, he didn't become a Christian solely because of the music, but without the music, I think he wouldn't have become a Christian. The music has honorably swept him into a community of more than feeling.
We may come back to all that, which is very interesting, but let's go to Bagel.
Thank you.
Someone, I've forgotten who it was, one of the famous masters, said, you don't come up to Oxford, you come up to Balliol.
Oh,
I think it was Keith Thomas who mentioned that in his interview. Is that how you felt on going to Balliol? You'd come to the centre of the universe. And why did you go there anyway?
Why did I go there? I went to Balliol because Cyril Bailey, the editor of Lucretius, was the chairman of the governors at King Alfred's School, Wantage. And we must have met on some occasion, and he and his wife invited me to tea. His wife was a very handsome and generous and good person who knew, as Cyril did, that the G in Gemma is hard. Okay, so she was Gemma. It was very important that she was not Gemma. And Cyril was terrifically alive in his blue eyes. He had lovely blue eyes, and he was able to convey some sort of affinity through his eyes when you were with him in the company of other people. Very, very remarkable. I knew that he was a great classical scholar. Houseman didn't think him great, but Houseman didn't think many people great, as you and I know. So it was a great bit of luck to know Cyril Bailey, and I've always liked old men. There are many old women that I like, but there are almost no old men that I don't like very much. I mean, they've been always important to me, and he was, in a way, the first of those. He was probably only 70 or 80. I think he died at more like 90. And without any ostentation, he just had lovely memories. He had been taught amateurishly to skate by Matthew Arnold, sort of frozen pond and so on, and at the edge of the pond, Arnold's wife and daughter saying, do be careful, so that was lovely. So there was some, did you once see Shelley playing, and so on, there was something of that. And when later on, when Geoffrey Faber's Life of Jowett came out, Cyril Bailey said that he was glad the book had been written, but you could not be in the room with Jowett for 1 minute and not feel the force of his genius. And on no page of Geoffrey Faber's book could you feel the force of genius. So I revered him. Now, I'd put in for St. John's, and was offered an exhibition at St. John's, which was fine, and I was going to go to St. John's, and I knew no protocol. Nobody from King Alfred School, Wantage, had gone to Oxford, so far as I could tell, from time immemorial. The Honours Board didn't record that, and nobody in my family had been to a university, which is still, of course, often the case in America. Boston University has a lot of first generation going to university people, and I'm touched by that, and so on. So Cyril said, no, don't go to St. John's, go to Balliol. and told me to apply for Balliol without himself taking stock. I mean, he by now is an old man, and the fact you couldn't do that. So I was offered a scholarship at Balliol, and then Poole, the head of St. John's, wrote me this absolutely withering note telling me that I had, you know, this was the worst thing since something or other, and so on. And it was very intemperate and wrong of him. I mean, that is, he should have said, young man, this is not something, you clearly didn't know, but you mayn't do this. Mm. Do you know what I mean? But I thought it was cruelly frigid letter to send to somebody who was 17. Mm. And he was coming from a school, you know, if I were a proctor from Eton and Tom, it would be very different. So that was a shock, and I found that very disturbing. I had no idea, I didn't know that nobody at St. Balliol cared a rat for what anybody at St. John's thought about anything. Anyway, so I put in for the scholarship. E.T. Williams, or Bill Williams, as for some reason he must have been the senior tutor at Balliol, and after the interview, following me and said that I would be given the scholarship, and he wanted to know what I would do about national service, and immediately proceeded to tell me what I would do, which is that you will do national service now, we suggest, instead of later, that you will go into the army, not any of the other services, and that in the army you will go into the infantry and learn how to be a soldier instead of going into the signal corps or the education corps. Of course, and it was actually very good advice and so on, and so I then did my 2 years. But Balliol was, as I say, there was this worse than hiccup or glitch. There was something which disconcerted me a lot for a while. I didn't know what it would be like to come back to Oxford, having apparently blotted a gigantic copybook. So that was the Balliol.
It was 1951 when you...
Well, it's 51, yes, that's right. I was in the army from 51 to 53. Hmm. So I was doing, I suppose it was 50 into 51. I don't remember that.
Just and the army, how was that, apart from reading Ibsen?
Well, I did basic training in Collinton Barracks, just outside Edinburgh. My Scottish blood was sort of kicking in. That was in the Royal Scots. I said to myself regularly, Donald, my older brother, 4 years ago was in this very barracks, and he survived this. He is not insane or done for, so I can survive it. But I had to keep saying that sort of thing. So basic training, but it was tiny people in kind of wasp stripe things, kind of wanting you to give up, wanting you not to give up, but wanting you to be at the brink of giving up all the time. But I got through that all right. I was then picked out for as officer material or something like that. Was sent to Eton Hall one of these things where you have to show that you can swarm up a rope and swim across a crocodile infested pond, and so I did all that, and it was held at so I was going to be a second lieutenant. I was there with Jonathan Wordsworth, collateral descendant of the poet, who after a while was invalided out because he had a varicose vein about the size of my little fingernail, and at the time I was rather vexed by his having eluded his duty, it seemed to me. But in the event, like a lot of things in the dispensation of Providence, in which I do not believe, it was a mercy for me because he went to Oxford a year before me and was therefore never competing with me for fellowships, because he'd already got his by the time it came for me to try to get mine, and he would have defeated me. The Wordsworth, the horse-shaped face of the Wordsworth and the name Wordsworth and the knowledge that there were sort of lots of family manuscripts still knocking about and so on. And he had great force of character, so it was a bit of luck that he'd already ensconced at Exeter when I needed a job at Worcester and so on. So the army, yeah.
You
then
went,
I.
You went abroad. You went to Egypt. Or?
Yes, I. Yeah. Once I got the commission, I was commissioned into the Green Howards. Mm. Alexandra, Princess of Wales, his own regiment. I would like that. Alexandra. Princess, I mean, surely she's from Scandinavia. Princess of Wales' own Yorkshire regiment. But it was a second battalion, which was lucky because it was almost entirely national service people. Mm. had a very good company commander called, it was like something in a novel, Jock Neighbour. What a wonderful name. And when I received an honour a few years ago, a letter came from Jock Neighbour saying, "Hope you remember me from when we were in the company." Very pleased to hear about this. You should join the Green Howards Regimental Association, which I did. Whereupon they disbanded the greenhouse. So I was guarding mounds of rotting potatoes with killer dogs. I didn't train the dogs and we didn't guard them effectively. We were saying for the millionth time we would never leave Egypt. Mm. We would never leave Cyprus either. Mm. We were clearly soon going to leave both. But it's important that it's prior to the Suez folly. Mm. So Suez made me know that I would never vote Conservative. Never, never, never. And that's foolish because the Labour Party sometimes is a stench in the nostrils of God, and one can hardly bring oneself to vote for it, but I can't vote Conservative.
So you never have voted Conservative?
No, no. Well, it wasn't just the folly of it, it was the lyings, and it was Selwyn Lloyd, it was collusion with the French, it was a very, very horrid anti-Arab feeling, which I was very aware of in Egypt, the whole kind of, you know. And all those claims that they couldn't possibly run the canal, why couldn't they run it? They ran it perfectly well. Hatred of Naguib as well as of Nasser, it wasn't true that it was a pretense that Farouk was somehow fun when he was not fun. I disliked all of that. But it was pointless being there, and clearly we were in it, but it wasn't ugly or disagreeable. I saw one dead person who somebody electrocuted themselves while ironing, and I'm sorry for them, but that was the only violence. I was lucky in that the people I'd been in officer training with did go to Malaya, and did go to Korea, so that it was a bit of luck what regiment I was in.
Then you came back to Dreaming Spires and you came up to read English. Who were the people who influenced you most of
that? I liked very much my tutor John Bryson, very, very much. He was an I don't know if you know anything about him. He was a very old-fashioned bell letterist. He did one superbly good thing, which is worth years and years of scholarship. He discovered the portrait of Donne with the great flaming red lips. He did it, as he acknowledged himself, with the help of an art historian, but he did it by asking not the usual question. It had a touch of the G.K. Chesterton or Agatha Christie about it. Edmund Goss, who was a pathological liar or untruth teller, had said that in his Life of Donne that there was a portrait of Donne in this particular place. Everybody had written to the particular great house, and they always wrote by saying, "No, please don't trouble us, we do not have any such." Bryson wrote and said, "Would you send me a list of all the portraits that you have?" They sent him a list of all the portraits, and one of them was of Donne Scotus. But it was a portrait of Donne. So that was sort of one. Now that didn't happen actually while I was an undergraduate, but in a way it was all sort of gathering in some huge gestation within John Bryson, who was just very, very endearing. He smoked non-stop, he stubbed them out all the time. He'd take two puffs and then he'd stub it out. That was clearly the sign of febrile intelligence and so on.
It might be, but James Campbell revealed in his interview that his pipe kept going out, and this was a ploy because he was trying to think of the next thing he wanted to comment on. Okay. He would knock out his pipe.
Oh, I see. Oh, that's right. Yeah. Well, that's the Raymond Williams. That's usually a left-wing move, I think. Raymond Williams was always sort of, you know, put the palm of your hand, you do all that, and I'm waiting and so on. Because it's important that the young men come forward and be forthcoming and all that sort of thing. Whereas really, we're all just itching to tell them what we think. Bryson was almost always late, so the key thing was somewhere between 20 past the hour and 25 past the hour, you had to decide whether he was going to come. He wouldn't be there probably before 20 past, but I was brought up to be there irrespective, and it might be one of these rare occasions when John, JNB, as he was known in the college, was on time. 25 past he wasn't there, so there was a sort of moment when you left, it was cold outside his room. He had a I liked very much the system of reading the essay aloud. I think it was good for one's prose.
Mm-hmm.
That it's difficult to write sentences like the tactile mesh of the TV mosaic has begun to permeate the whole sensorium if you've actually got to utter it, as against having it lying there like some squalid thing on the page. So I think it was good for prose that people read. Bryson didn't want to listen to the whole thing, it was absolutely clear. But he had built in some ability to know when one was getting near the end. I've set this down actually for the Balliol College record somewhere. But so you could try to defeat him. You could think, my essay today is going to be only 8 minutes long, or 3 minutes long, or it's going to be 28 minutes long. And Bryson will not know when it's going to come to an end. Because always he would say, took a bit of time to get going, I think, but the point you made near the end, about the song. So that was all. So you desperately wished. He'd sit at his desk and you'd hear the strange noise. This was him opening his letters with a paper knife and reading his letters while I was saying. Meanwhile, of course, the metaphysical poets were by no means at one. Or thus we see these necessary tropes and so on. So there's this strange sound, which for a while I fancied was his zip fastener on his trousers. There was this sort of noise and so on. But no, it wasn't. It was only him reading his letters and so on. And then at the end, he would say some really good, penetrating thing and so on. But I was very fond of him.
Mm.
It was totally without pretension. He said, the point of studying English is that you'll have for the rest of your life a body of great things in your mind and more than your mind. You will know these things and they will be a lifetime resource for you. There wasn't anything about it'll help you be a good teacher or anything like that. It wasn't at all leave aside.
Mm.
So it was a good thing that J.C. Maxwell had been the Andrew Bradley Research Fellow and had given Leavis's books to the college library. So I was lucky in that my cast of mind wasn't at all like my tutors.
Mm.
I was going to be reading Empson and Leavis and so on, irrespective, and it was very good that there was somebody who simply said, how many other masks have you read? And so that was the right question. So I liked him a lot.
Mm.
Alistair Campbell was the professor of Old English, was the tutor in Old English. He wasn't at that point a professor. He was very eccentric. He rather knew that he was eccentric so that it was somewhat stylized and therefore less effective. When William the Conqueror comes in, I go out. after 1066 or after the 13th century, there isn't any literature, there are only books. Somebody the other day mentioned Hamlet in an essay. If you let them mention Hamlet, they'll mention anything. This was Alistair, but you could feel it was rather fabric-like sort of things that Hitchcock said or something. It was slightly. But he was a real scholar, so it was good to be in the company of somebody who's a real scholar. And we loved the stories about him, which were probably true, that he played golf with two balls and claimed that it was the same as playing 18 holes. That every year in the summer he went to Frisia and won a huge prize for a novel written in the language, a prize for which nobody else ever entered. It was a bit like the Suetonian Prize in Praise of God or something, which for years Cambridge had desperately tried to get. Derek Brewer, the master of, is it the master of Emmanuel?
Yes, I don't know. Really.
I think regularly supplemented his income by winning these religious prizes, knowing that nobody otherwise ever put in for them. So that's all right. I liked it. Bryson had wanted to admit only me, not because I was transcendently good, but because the fewer student pupils he had, the better.
Mm.
And the college apparently said, no, it's not fair to admit one person to read the subject in any 1 year. You really must take somebody else. So he took one other person who became the biographer of Noel Coward. And to the end of the 3 years, Alistair Campbell never knew which of us was which. Here is this wonderful tutorial system in which week after week you study with somebody and so on. At the end, after 3 years, Campbell would hand back, he'd say, well done, Day, and he'd hand me this piece of work. And I'd say, I'm Rick this Day. So this was the Oxford system at its best.
Wonderful.
Bryson had one great joke, and I thought this was for me pure Oxford in a way at its best. He had a lovely Hilliard miniature, and Leslie Hodson, whom Freddie Bateson had quipped, Freddie's a relation of your Patrick Bateson, mm-hmm. you know. Freddie had written a lovely piece called Elementary, My Dear Hodson, complaining about some of Hodson's detective works for the, about the sonnets. Anyway, Bryson had the Hilliard miniature, and Hodson entered the room, saw it, said, "That's Mr. W.H.," and then wrote a book about it and so on. Somebody said to Bryson, "How on earth did Hodson know that it was Mr. W.H.?" And Bryson replied, "I didn't think it proper to ask." it's actually wonderful. I mean, it's the hetero, you know, it's the homosexual world over centuries. I didn't think proper. Ah, yes. Isn't it good?
Lovely.
I miss that sort of thing in America. Nobody in America ever says something like, "I didn't think it proper."
One of the people you haven't mentioned, well, you mentioned before in another context, but must have been lecturing, was C.S. Lewis when you were there.
Yes.
What was your...
I went his lectures. I didn't go to a lot of lectures. I never missed tutorials in the college.
Yeah.
I went to lectures, but not all that much. I spent a lot of time reading and rereading, sitting in my room, and not reading secondary things, always reading primary things and so on. Lewis didn't seem to me to be a great lecturer. I mean, it was fine, and he was wonderfully well informed, and he cared about what he was saying. But I have been at lectures where I thought this is an extraordinary accomplishment. Quentin Skinner's lectures are extraordinary accomplishments. Lewis didn't seem to me to be like that. He left Oxford for Cambridge, you will know when, though he kept a house here in Headington, I think that's right. I was going to meet him, and I don't have the details of this. After my Milton book came out, there was some kind of tentative suggestion that I would come to tea. It's funny that I don't have any clearer record or any piece of paper. And then he died. He must have died. Can you remember when he died? The book was 1963. I think that's right. So, I mean, I admired reading him. I think him a much better literary critic than anything else. I don't think him a good poet. I don't really think him a good novelist. I think him and I don't really think him a good polemicist. The old stories of, you know, his having given up certain kinds of argument about miracles when Miss Anscombe wiped the floor with him. But I think in a Chestertonian way, some of his best jokes are Chestertonian, or even from Chesterton. You don't then you think, somebody else had used the phrase giant to the Jack killer before you did, Jack Lewis, and so on. I'm always interested in people who have a name, a bit like Bill Williams, which is can't possibly be deduced from their initials. And there's something about Clive Staples Lewis being Jack, which was sort of disconcerting to me.
What about the other members of that, whatever they would call themselves, I've forgotten?
Oh yes, the Inklings, yes. Tolkien was the most boring lecturer I've been at. He didn't take any trouble at all. He simply kind of rattled away with a copy of the co-edited Gawain and the Green Knight in his hand. Auden was I suppose I was perhaps already a graduate student when Auden was praising Tolkien's creative achievements and so on. But I didn't. Helen Gardner was a very good lecturer, but it wasn't remarkable. It wasn't remarkable force of personality at a podium then. I don't think Oxford English was remarkable for that.
Isaiah Berlin, is he? Then.
Well, I wasn't told the only non-English faculty person whose name was ever bruited or mooted was Vint, and we were all supposed to go and we would understand iconography and all the visual arts if we went to Edgar Vint, but I didn't do that. I tended simply to be reading and rereading and rereading, and that was fine. I hadn't heard tell of Berlin. I love the Berlin stories that I've heard tell off since then, of course. I mean, some of the great stories. You will know.
Tell.
His remark about George Steiner, very interesting phenomenon, very common on the continent, very rare in England, genuine charlatan.
No, it is a wonderful remark, and it's very good because it's sort of, it is in a way anti-British that we don't even produce genuine Charlatans. I think it's absolutely wonderful. Or the other one, when leaving one of George Steiner's lectures, he was heard by a friend of mine to say, "I enjoyed that, perhaps not quite in the way intended." Isn't that good? It's absolutely wonderful. I love all of that. But that's the world of Geoffrey Madden's notebooks that I was mentioning to you. And there was an occasion, and actually it was Berlin who said this. I knew Berlin very, very slightly because later on I knew Jim Griffin and his wife, Catherine Griffin, where there was a family connection with Isaiah Berlin. But I had quoted the Joseph remark I quoted to you earlier today. Oh good, then there'll be more room in the car. Mm. Joseph, not more room, surely, simply less of it occupied. I may not be verbatim, that's just a bit. And Berlin said, oh no, that's quite unjust and so on. And then you always know it's going to be an even more damaging story. As soon as people say, no. So he said, Joseph, this was a Joseph story. A young man comes, taps on the door, is welcomed by Joseph, who has an appointment with him. Joseph says, would you like to take tea? A little bit like here, would you like to take tea? And the young man says, well, that's very good of you, Professor Joseph. I have just come from London, that would be wonderful. Rings for the college servant. The college servant appears, and Joseph says, there will be tea after all. There's a whole flowering, crystallizing of a whole civilization in there. Isn't that terrible? Isn't it terrible? Isn't it wonderful that you can do that much with the words after all? Mm. Isn't it good? It's terribly, young people should not be treated like that. One's juniors should not be treated like that. Mm. From a young man from the junior to the senior, it would be forgivable. So, but. No, I didn't listen to, I didn't hear. And I didn't know about Austin.
Mm.
The real loss I feel is that nobody said to me, there's a philosopher called J.L. Austin, even as an undergraduate, you, Christopher, care about Empson, you should go and hear Austin. Mm. I think one of the few essays I've written about a philosopher is an essay on Austin. I think him a wonderful writer. Perverse about literature and the arts and needing to be, as it were, corrected, but simply wonderful.
Who were the writers who, as an undergraduate, you were particularly passionate about?
Well, I was in this rather unlovely way, dedicated to reading things that were on the syllabus. Do you mean that is, and the syllabus course ended in 1830 or 1832. Mm. I did as an undergraduate the extra paper, which took, you could take a paper on the Victorians. Mm. The word was, it wasn't the word I saw written down, that if you did badly in it, it wasn't taken into account. If you did well in it, it was taken into account. Mm. The price you paid for it, of course, is the time that you took preparing for the exam that would otherwise have been spent, and so on. So 18. And of course, there was no study of any living writer or contemporary writer. But I was in the event, I was pleased to do that. And you're back in a time when Victorian studies were condescended to. Mm. I mean, that is, John Bryson edited Matthew Arnold, a very nice selection from Arnold, but you had no standing except as a Renaissance or Augustan scholar. Mm. Clearly the professorships were going to go to people who had worked either like Helen Gardner on the Renaissance or the editors of Pope and so on. That was serious scholarship. David Nicol Smith supervised me briefly for a while. I was supervised as a B-Lit student, which was all that I did. Supervised by Herbert Davis, who was a very fine Swift scholar. He went on sabbatical for a term, and I went to David Nicol Smith, who was the doyen of all that. Nicol Smith, on one occasion I mentioned PMLA, and Nicol Smith said, I wouldn't bother too much with those magazines if I were you. As if it were Cosmopolitan or Lilliput. And it was a different era. That is, you did it by consulting your own wonderful library and this. You didn't care about what people... It was anti the professionalism. In a funny way, it and Leavis agreed. Leavis detested, as it were, that world of belles lettres scholarship, but at the same time they were both opposed to the professionalization of literary study. Thought that it has to remain in touch with something which would risk the accusation of being amateurish, because the amateur sees and values certain things and so on.
So this is when you started to be particularly interested in Victorian writers?
It probably would be. Though I didn't know what to do when I was going to do the B-Lit, I didn't know what to do. If my Latin had been good, I would have wanted to work on Gower. Mm. I thought and still think him a wonderful poet, and I've written an essay about him, and Lewis had written very beautifully about him in The Allegory of Love. And I toyed with that in the knowledge that the B-Lit is a training in sources, authorities and methods, and doesn't have to be an original contribution of knowledge. And it's, I think, a very good degree, because it postpones a decision as to what you actually want to write a book about, and so on. So I did in Augustan poetry. I looked at various literary kinds after Pope practiced them. So what was the fate of pastorals for the 50 years following Pope, and what was the fate of epistolary satire for 50 years? So it was it had no point other than for me to have a training in sources, authorities and methods. It gained the degree, and only that, and I've never published anything from it, nor should I. There's nothing but publishing in it. Then I got the Worcester job. Mm. I was very lucky in that my opponent for the Worcester job was John Jones, an immensely gifted lawyer turned literary critic who was at Merton. I was very lucky in that the first words of his first book, about why late Wordsworth is underrated, a good book, the egotistical sublime, the first words were, "This is a book of some pretensions in that it seeks to minister to truths which too often lie bedridden in the outhouse of the soul." Now, this was a bit of luck, because any fellow of Worcester picking up this book and reading the words, "This is a book of some pretensions in it," and so on, would think, "Not, I think, for our young men," and so on. It was, as one says, of course, a quotation from Coleridge, though you had to read on a little bit before you. So that was a bit of luck, because he and I dined, I think, the same night, that rather macabre ceremony by which the two or three people who are in the running for the fellowship having dinner at the same time. Colleges appraising them. They weren't sure that somebody who'd been a lawyer and become a literary type was quite the thing, and they did know they didn't want somebody whose first words of the first book were those. And so on. No, he's very, very, really gifted man, really, really gifted. So I was lucky with that, and I never, of course, thought I would leave Worcester. Mm. I was there. One of the happiest days of my life was hearing that I'd got the.
So you went to Worcester in 58?
58, yes. I had 2 years at Balliol. After one of those, I gained the Andrew Bradley Junior Research Fellowship, so that was very, very good. Trying to destroy the master was the sport at the time.
So it was Masterman.
Balliol. At Balliol, the hope was to destroy David Lindsay Keir, with the fear that he might have destroyed himself before you could do it. It was particularly irritating. There were wonderful Keir stories. An undergraduate say, at handshaking, Keir never listened. So that at handshaking, and it was clear that something wafted in somehow. So he would say, "This is very promising, Smethurst," and so on. And actually what he just heard was that Smethurst's work had been no good at all, not the Smethurst that you and I know, and so on. So on one occasion, he did listen, and the undergraduate was rebuked for doing little more really than offer a summary of received opinion on the subject. So he said, "This will not do, Mr. So-and-so," offering. Whereupon the undergraduate said, "It ill becomes you, Master," this was very good, "it ill becomes you, Master, who in the preface to your Constitutional History of England say that your book makes no pretense other than to offer..." Isn't this good? I mean, that's the Oxford undergraduate at his best. Rounding upon the master by quoting the master's own words back at him. I thought that was great.
Mm. When you came in 58, I think that's the same year as James Campbell probably came to, or maybe it's the year before.
Yeah, Harry Pitt was certainly, I talked to my friend Paul Streeton about whom I might like at Worcester, because I didn't know anybody in the college. And Paul said, "You will like Harry Pitt very much," and I did. And through Harry, I met James and knew him, liked it, the man. Mm. Not the best dressed man, I think, in Oxford, but.
No, a rather absent minded Donish, but.
But very good.
Were there others that I mean, tell me something about your time at Worcester. You said it was a happy time. You enjoyed it.
Yes, I enjoy it very much. I did. I wearied of giving that many tutorials. I think I did 15 hours a week of tutorials, and I think that there were various reasons why I left. None of them was pique or petulance or a quarrel. I looked around at dinner one night, and every single person dining that evening who had come after, who was in this sense junior to me, had come later, I had voted against. Now, I didn't dislike the six or eight people in question, but it was rather remarkable. I thought, is it ever going to be somebody? Because the college was committed to the idea that of a good college man, rather narrowly defined, a good college man was somebody who would be particularly good with the weaker young men. So that there'd be a moment at which you would think, might we not occasionally think about the very good people who come here? It's true that we were sort of third choice. The Etonian link was very powerful through Masterman and through my predecessor, Colonel C.H. Wilkinson. So Etonians who didn't want to go to the House or Trinity would come to us, and they would leave the college not knowing how to spell Othello, because they pronounced it Othello. So then Othello comes back, and he finds, of course, his great surprise, and says, Othello business, so R-T-H, not Miller. And they would be people who would say, I can't, of course, be here next week, it's Henley, you know. So it was like being a governess in a Victorian, but they were not many of those. But after 10, I lost 3% every year, I realised. That is the uninteresting bottom 3%. So after 10 years, 30% of the students I didn't want to have a conversation about Swift with. And I couldn't vary it. I mean, the thing with the tutorial system is you can't vary. You're no good saying, I'm no longer interested in Victorian things, I can do something else. You had to do King Lear and Pope's Dunciad and the Prelude and Don Quixote. I don't know. So I decided I didn't want to be there. But there were lots of characters in the college, but I'm not sure about Oxford and Cambridge characters. Let me think. Richard Sayce felling David Mitchell during the tea break of a governing body meeting because David Mitchell had inadvertently referred favourably to something French, which was of course Richard Sayce's subject, but Richard took it that he was praising the Maison Française, who had evicted Richard from his house. So it's one of these moments, you don't often see people felled.
You mean felled?
Yeah, physically felled. It was rather struck. You know. I mean, he may not have actually been spread-eagled and done that. My colleague in English was a man called David Evans, who was the object of contumely from many of the fellows. He was a lecturer, and there was a lot of patronage of him. Remember at lunchtime, which somebody turned to David Evans said, you have a Labour face. And it was very good because, of course, it was sort of true. I mean, that is in some terrible way. David Evans's Welsh face and his glasses, he did have a Labour, but there were these funny submerged things. One night, combining, they were praising, there was a lot of praising themselves. I mean, I think maybe combination rooms and common rooms do that. They were praising themselves for not having appointed Maurice Barra. Not on the good grounds that in the end he was much less important as a classical scholar than you might have thought, but on the grounds they were quite right to have appointed Armitage Noel Brian Brown, who was one of the most boring people on the planet and so on, sort of totem pole person and so on, immense narrowness and severity and so on. So they were praising him and so on. David Evans made the mistake of, they said, they had something like, you know, dedicated to some. David Evans said, if you mean that he is a prep school master monkey, I agree with you. Now, it was something about monkey there. prep school master monkey. After dinner, David Evans was taken aside by David Mitchell, who said, you are not to speak like that of a colleague in the presence of the servants. And it was so wonderful because you imagine her going, say, yeah, then he called him a prep school master monkey. it was so absolutely, but it was everything that people also dislike of Labour, dislike of Welsh people, that's coming into it. David Evans said to Richard Sayce one day, knowing about the etymology of the name Sayce and its relation to Sassenach, he said, "When did the Sayces leave Wales?" And Richard Sayce says, "Has it ever occurred to you that there are advantages in minding your own business?" I try to think of what Oxford and Cambridge are like. That's what they're like. It's somebody asking a not particularly interesting but perfectly innocent question about the etymology of a name. And it's the "did it ever occur to you" bit that's so good. It's actually one. What a world. So that was all part of the hurly-burly of the college. You were supposed to love the college. David Mitchell said to me one night, he drank a lot of sherry and his eyes were red with it, "Do you love this college?" Now, I'm sitting next to him at dinner, I immediately become sort of pebbly. I said, "Well, do you love it?"
Sounds like Desdemona.
Yeah. It had to do, of course, with insecurity and all that kind of stuff.
Were you able to do any of your own? I mean, you were beginning to edit.
Well, I was writing the book about Milton is exactly 50 years ago. So for my 80th birthday, Boston University thinks it might have a Milton occasion because it's 50 years since Milton's grand star and so on. So that was giving university lectures. And
did you enjoy lecturing?
Yeah, I love lecturing.
I can see.
Carl Miller on one occasion said, somebody said, "Christopher enjoyed culpably." Carl said, "This was Scottish, just the one word, culpably." That's all. I think one shouldn't. There could be too much showbiz and enjoying myself, but not at all to enjoy it. No, shouldn't do it then.
So you were lecturing on Milton and then you...
Lecturing on Milton and Jacobean tragedy and things like that. Then Freddie Bateson. Freddie was the most important person to me. I was very, very fond of John Bryson. Freddie Bateson was teaching the B-Lit and I went to his classes and he did two huge things for me. One was very early to ask me to be the reviews editor for Essays and Criticism, which, as you know, is the sibling for Past and Present.
Yeah.
Freddie had founded it simply from his own efforts, basically to educate the Oxford English faculty and to encourage those who didn't have a morbid horror of the printing press to print some good things. And he had a very good organ. So he offered me that when I was really very young, and he asked me not long after to edit Tennyson. Well, he asked me whom I would like to edit in the Longman series, and I knew that there were lots and lots of Tennyson poems that had either not been collected or not even been published, and I knew it from the writings of Tennyson's grandson. So that was a wonderful opportunity, and he was a very good and generous person. I wept more at his funeral than at any funeral I've ever been. I mean, he died at a ripe old age. It wasn't a sudden loss. But I was so, so, so fond of him. And he brought forward a whole slew of very good people. Roger Lonsdale editing 18th century poetry. Alistair Fowler and John Carey from Oxford both editing Milton. It was a really great list that Freddie, a great thing he did for Oxford English. And he was bitterly condescended to by the faculty. He was never allowed to examine. I was never allowed to examine. I taught for 10 years in the Oxford English faculty. I was on one occasion allowed to examine in the past school. The line was that a balanced board meant that every individual member of it was balanced. So Freddie Bateson was denied it on the grounds that he wasn't a balanced...
Like a football team, which all of them could play in all positions on the football team.
It made for mediocrity in the examining board. Because the examination system was lovely. My favourite examining story was when John Hale, the historian of Italy and of art, I only know it from and I was told it by him. At one point he said that thing which Roger would say, "And what will you be doing now?" And the woman who was speaking drew her knees back sharply and said, "I do think I should be getting back to London." There were 12 people in kind of funereal garb and sort of men of immense ugliness, and she thought she'd been propositioned by John Hale. It was too, "I think I should be getting back to London." Good.
Wonderful. It's strange you weren't allowed to examine, but it was a release because that examining system whereby you had all the exams at the end of 3 years, and
yes,
it was a hell of someone really for those yeah. who were examining, wasn't it?
But I loved it. I liked the long haul.
Mm.
I tried to explain to my American students that they're in the position of people who can't ever go bankrupt or ever invest any time or money or energy, because you're judged at every stage. That is, you know, your transcript says how you did in every subject in every semester, and that is itself based on an aggregate of the 5 essays that you wrote during the course of that semester. So it's as if your annual salary were paid every day. So you can never go bankrupt, and you can never invest. Whereas the Oxford system allowed you to invest 3 years, either wisely or foolishly. And I thought it was a much better system.
Yeah. But you taught in America for a long time. Is that because you can go on longer there, or because you do find things about America that...
I teach in America because I married Judith Aronson in... 37 years ago. My first wife, Kirsten, had left me for the Regius Professor of Greek. He was a professor of Greek at Cambridge. I'd been at Bristol at the time. And he moved here, and he left his wife and took mine, as it were. Hence the term husband-in-law, which I think is a very useful term. I, in a way, not altogether wisely, then thought, I'll put him for a professorship. When they advertised a professorship at Cambridge, I thought, I'll show them. So I came to Cambridge. I went to America after 11 years in Cambridge because Judith, who is 8 years younger than I am, her parents were still alive and mine were not. My work was more portable than hers because she's a graphic designer.
She's American.
She's American, yes. I had met her at the home of... She was the roommate of a student of mine at Worcester, whom I taught next year, it will be 50 years ago. Stephen Eisenberg's wife, Barbara Eisenberg, was a roommate of Judith, and I was in New York at a time when the marriage was falling apart, and met her. And then a few years after the split, Judith and I married. So the going to America was not the almighty dollar, and it wasn't happy in Cambridge really because there were terrible rows. But I would never have left Cambridge because I had done jury service. I'd been chairman of the faculty board. I could have simply looked at my fingernails for 20 years and so on. Not quite 20, but I was aware that if I went to America I wouldn't have to retire at 67. So that, and I wanted to go when I was nearer 50 than 60. And when Judith was nearer 40 than 50, you know what I mean? So I don't regret it, though it has been strange to see one's children become Americans. So it was 3, 5, and 7 when we went there. But that's basically that story.
And your reflections on the difference of the teaching. You don't have a tutorial system, obviously,
yeah.
and you have assessment, continuous assessment.
Yes.
What are the other main structural differences in
there? Well, the main thing that is really bad about it, though much less corrupting than, oddly less corrupting than it sort of ought to be, is simply the teacher being the examiner. American undergraduates are astonished to reflect upon this. They say, don't you think it's strange that after all, the person who gives you the driving lessons does not give you the driving test. The publishers do not write reviews of their books, though actually they increasingly do through blogs and through lying, so on. But so the American says, oh yes, that's true. But of course, it's a price ring. It suits both teachers and taught to not have anybody else coming in to judge how well you taught. It has led to this huge escalation, inflation of grades. It's an immense part of the sexual harassment world. There's not just this person is teaching, this person is giving you an A or a B, or but in fact, the whole of your career, you know, the whole future is the... So that I've not been able to... I bring it up, it's like Carthage ought to be destroyed or King Charles's head. I bring it up whenever there's a discussion in the faculty and people say, well, I see what you mean, and they have no intention of changing it at all. That's much after all important.
It's not the case with PhDs, is it? Because you have
No, I'm afraid it is. No, the predominant people in any PhD are the people who've worked on it with you in America. your first and second readers mm. are your first and second members of your committee. It's the opposite. I mean, Cambridge, after all, these are the very people who are precluded from judging it.
Mm.
It's a terrible system.
Mm. What about the level, the standard of the students?
That has more, I think, to do with the standing of the universities than with the differences of system.
Mm.
Pretty well every student at Boston University would rather be somewhere else.
Mm.
Now, that's not simply a bad thing, because at least they do not think that they are God's gift to scholarship. I mean, Oxford and Cambridge people spend the first year congratulating themselves on having got in.
Mm.
If they got into Oxford and Cambridge, why should they be expected to learn anything? Sure, excuse me, we've given proof that we don't need to learn anything, haven't we? Done in Harvard, the unremitting, 350 years of unremitting self-congratulation take their toll.
Mm.
The BU people would rather be somewhere else, except that Boston University is a very good second-rank university, which is in some respects first-rate.
Mm.
It's not a second-rate university, it's a second-rank university with some pockets. I think economics is now very, very good.
Mm.
And philosophy was very good when Hinteregger presided over it. And so I tell you, this is real. They'd rather be somewhere else, except that Boston University has given them a good deal in terms of scholarships and so on. They like the city of Boston, and it's quite good enough for people to. Most of the faculty would rather be somewhere else, and that's less good.
Mm.
I think the best members of the faculty are the people who've been somewhere else, as I've been taught in Oxford and Cambridge, good to stay in Oxford and Cambridge, and I'm not concerned with whether or not noses are looked down.
Mm.
My first week in Cambridge, Massachusetts, students and I were having drinks across the road and so on, and some well-dressed lady says to me, "What do you do?" I say, "I teach Harvard." No, Boston University. Fascinating, she said, and she was already moving across the room to talk to somebody else. I mean, immense, immense snobbery and so on and so that. I mean, it was a commuter school at this, then the other.
Mm.
It's the place where I've most enjoyed teaching. Especially the teaching that is anything like seminars and lectures as against tutorials. And I think people weary of giving tutorials.
Mm.
The director of studies system, of course, is radically different from the Oxford system,
yes.
Isn't it?
Yes.
I mean, I taught everything from, as it were, Chaucer up to whenever we would end, let's say, the Great War back then.
Yeah.
So I was a general practitioner in the college and a consultant in the faculty.
Mm.
And I thought that was a wonderful combination.
Mm.
But I think people weary of it.
Mm.
Finding some way of moving on from the week X number of weekly tutorials. But and then maybe is it different now? You can tell me perhaps about it.
Mm. I will after.
You will again. Sorry.
What tends to happen in interviews that the last 30, 40 years of a life get swept away in 1 minute, as we've had to do more or less, because it would be very nice to, well, we may have time to come back to it, but to talk more about your own work. And one way into that is sometimes fruitful, which is to say a kind of Desert Island Discs approach, which is that if you were to choose three of your pieces of work which you'd like to be remembered by most, what would they be and why would you choose them?
Thank you. Freddie Bateson mattered to me because he wrote a book called The Scholar Critic, and because he thought that it was essential for people to be literary historians and literary critics and editors. He thought it was very bad that these had been apportioned out. Realism asked that people might be much better at one than at the other, but you'd got to be, you had in some way to be all three, or to do all three sometime or other. Do you know what I mean? So he was an editor of Pope and of the Cambridge Bibliography, but the author of a sort of critical biography of Wordsworth and of a book on English poetry in the English language, which was partly linguistic and partly what then was rightly thought to be literary theory, but is now sort of horse and buggy stuff because it's not tricked out or trapped out with kind of jargons and so on. So different kinds of things. editions last best. Nothing lasts forever. The word definitive should never be used. There are things that are authoritative or have the authority. I mean, the Harford and Simpson, Ben Jonson, it was not a definitive, it was an authoritative edition. It will never be entirely superseded because the decisions that it took will always have something to be said for them as against subsequent decisions and so on. So I think the longest lasting things are likely to be editions. My edition of Tennyson has been out of print for a long time, and thinking last night before going to sleep, though not consciously thinking of the fact that you and I were going to speak, I wondered whether, I've just been told that Longman has been bought by another publishing house, and that the fate of that series of annotated English poets, which Freddie Bateson was the general editor of, is rather uncertain. I would quite like to get somebody young to update my Tennyson. It would be worthwhile work. It wouldn't be a huge job of work, but it hasn't really been dealt with once the Trinity College manuscripts were released. Mm. If I stay with that for a moment, you know, when I originally did it, the manuscripts of Trinity were under permanent embargo. That is, Hallam Tennyson gave them to the college on condition in perpetuity that they not be quoted or copied, but that they be read. Now, the college should never have accepted the conditions.
This is Trinity, Cambridge.
Trinity, Cambridge, yeah. Mm-hmm. And the college shouldn't have accepted the conditions, but of course it was a wonderful benefaction. Mm-hmm. Sir Charles Tennyson, the poet's grandchild, and the then Lord Tennyson besought the college to abolish the condition. So the poet's grandson. It needed a change of librarian, actually. Philip Gaskell came to the college, and it was. So my edition was rendered obsolete in the year in which it was published, because it said on every other page, which may not be quoted, which may not, so it was carted or to be destroyed again, which may not be quoted, which may not be quoted. And it became the case that I could quote them. But of course I had to wait for the selling out of that first edition and my doing the work and so on. So that's one kind of thing, and I would like to think that the edition of T.S. Eliot's poems, which is nearing completion, I'm doing it with somebody else, and there have proved to be contractual problems about that matter, which is not, it's not secret, but it's a problem when two editors disagree as to what their contract with the publisher should be. It was not a competition between my co-editor and me, it was a competition between my co-editor and Faber and Faber. So that has been, in the last couple of months, a matter of sleeplessness for me, and it is still not resolved. I think within this next week it will be resolved. It's not a, as I say, it's not. It's a disagreement between us of a very important kind, but it's basically because he disagrees with the publisher as to what he should be granted in the editing by them. But I think in addition, editions last best. So I'm really pleased with the Eliot, and I think the Eliot isn't a greater poet than Tennyson, but there is no annotated edition of Eliot at all, that he didn't wish there to be such a thing. His widow for a long time did not wish there to be such a thing. She changed her mind, as it were, 15 years ago, invited me. Eliot had sent a solicitor's letter wishing to sue me unless I withdrew something at a certain point. So it was rather wonderful, ironical and generous that she invited me to edit in Inventions of March Madness, 50 unpublished early poems. So that I'm pleased with, because I think it's the kind of thing which has a good chance of actually never being superseded. We have a better edition of Jane Austen than R.W. Chapman did in certain respects, but only in certain respects. And so on. So that. I like it when I do something which rests on the second thing, if it's in literary criticism terms. There's a very beautiful remark by Eliot. 1 year into the Criterion, he sort of sums up what he thinks he has been trying to do with the Criterion, and he says it should be the task of a literary journal. This will not be quite verbatim, but the task of a literary journal to exhibit the relations of literature not to life as something contrasted with literature, but to all the other things which, together with literature, are the components of life. So it's an absolutely wonderful, wonderfully truthful, wise formulation. Not literature against life. Literature is as much part of life as anything else. Relation of literature to all the other things which together with literature are the components of life. So I do very much like my book on Keats and embarrassment, in that I think it's not an interdisciplinary book, because I have no disciplinary power or cognizance when it comes to understanding Darwin on the expression of emotions in man and animals. But it uses Darwin, and it uses Sartre and so on. It uses a whole lot of people who've cared about blushing in order to think about something which is, to me, important, irrespective of whether Keats had ever written poems about it. I mean, I think it's characteristic of great artists to write about things which are important, whether they get written about or not, and certainly about whether... So I'm of the books, in a way, I'm most pleased with that. People tell... When gratitude is ever expressed to me, as it was in China recently, it will be for the Milton book, because the Milton book, it's close reading in the interests of something which was then very puzzling to me. I knew and still know that Eliot and Leavis are great critics. Leavis is the greatest of the critics who is not himself a creator. The immense number of indictments of him which are justified, but very, very extraordinary to be not a poet or a novelist, and to be that penetrating, and to know what's unignorable. The questions he raises really must not be ignored, and so on. On the other hand, Milton seemed to me to be one, so there's a bit of a problem. Milton is a delight to me to read, and these are great critics, so there's something that needs to be sorted out. And that meant for me saying that Eliot and Leavis are right about what Milton is like in certain respects, do you see what I mean? You disagree partly with their description of what is the case and partly with their principles and so on, whilst. And the same with the Keats. I mean, if these lines from Keats are terrible, why are they so memorable? Now, one answer to that could be there's no relation between lines being good and being memorable, but there's a little bit of a problem with that. So what's so wrong with being adolescent? If people write to say it's very adolescent, why do they mean by that it therefore doesn't have anything wise about it? As if Keats's own dismay about his adolescence were not a genuine struggle. I mean, he knows that he pays a price still for being adolescent, he would like, and so on. So I think one has to start with some sort of puzzle. There's something puzzling. And recently, Geoffrey Hill's relation to T.S. Eliot is for me deeply puzzling. Geoffrey's poems, best poems, are profoundly indebted.
Geoffrey Hill.
Profoundly indebted to Eliot. They would not have been written without Eliot. They're not pastiche Eliot or parodic Eliot, but they're precipitated by Eliot and wonderful new efflorescence in a way in which Tennyson is precipitated by Keats or Wordsworth by Milton. Really, really wonderful. Why then does Geoffrey Hill repeatedly speak ill of Eliot as a poet, including the poems which his poems draw upon? So there's something that I like to start with something which is really a puzzle. And the answer might be original sin, envy. I mean, you've got a whole... But there's something to work out there. What's going on when? So those are the things I like doing. There are things I'm not good at. I mean, well, of course, everyone. I'm not good at middle tissue. If I had to explain to somebody why Donald Davey is a better critic than I am, now he never did any really valuable editing. He gathered some things to, he would make a selection of a certain kind of 18th century poem that was well worth doing, but he was never an editor, so I'm not going to yield to him in every respect. But his critical writing is very good at a middle tissue. It's not simply instances illuminating, analyzed, and it's not simply a large general proposition or narration. There's a middle thing which he's very good at doing, and I've never been good at doing it. if the essay is the natural, if the essay is one's natural form, it doesn't matter so much. Mm. But it matters with a book, if it matters if something's claiming to be a whole book. Mm. And I'm very aware of the people who've got that ability to have something that goes across from, saves it from being just an anthology of instances or a general proposition, the return of grand theory and so on. Trilling was very good at that. There's a tissue that connects the minute instance imaginatively analysed and the general proposition about the fate of pleasure. It's not just here's a proposition, something happened to pleasure in the romantic period, here are some instances of Wordsworth not being quite sure what he wants to do with pleasure and so on. And, but there's some
how do you work? I mean, you, that is the nitty gritty of it. I mean, do you tend to write longhand? Do you tend to type into a computer? Do you tend to take lots of walks? Do you tend to have your good ideas, even if they're not creative, in the bath, or, you know, the practicalities of actually working? And what advice would you give to younger people about how to work?
Well, the when seen, make a note of thing. I work almost entirely on a computer, and it's true that editing is terrifically helped by the. That is, the computer. I'm not telling you, reminding you things that would be all too clear. The discrete item is wonderfully served by the computer. That is, if I need to change a note on Elliot, I can change it. I can just insert this and change it, and it's not messing around with lots of pieces of paper and so on. Though I think scissors and paste is still the best way for an immense number of things. There's a certain kind of talk I'm going to give, photocopy this and this and put it together. I tend to give talks from notes rather than write them out. But I write straight onto the computer, and I use the computer only as a glorified typewriter. I don't do anything that involves anything more than the word spreadsheet strikes a chill into my arms. I don't do any of that. There is no substitute for having for a long time jotted things down. You know, so that it's funny, I've been putting together Keynesiana that have to do with Eliot. Keynes reading Eliot on the BBC in 1936, and why he. So I put it down because I'm interested in Keynes. I'm interested in Eliot. John Maynard Keynes, yes. And then there's a certain point at which it might form a. But you might have enough for it to form a pattern. I don't know. I don't know any German, but people say aha, Leibniz and so on. But almost everything that I do has been incremental. At a certain point, it seems to me. Well, I remember exactly where I was on Beaumont Street in Oxford when I realised that Tennyson's use of passages which he'd written for quite other poems. Now, the phenomenon had long been recognised. Sir Charles Tennyson wrote about it. But I had done a lot of editorial work and had built up many, many more instances. This which turns up in Ulysses was written for a different poem. This which turns up in The Princess was written for a different poem and so on. And so I'd got lots of instances. And then suddenly I realised that they were all about time. They all spoke about time. Now, so that wasn't an amazing, you know, that's not a revolutionary thought, but I'd suddenly say, that they're passages which are themselves preserved through time. They haven't yet reached their due time. There's something about them and so on. And then I realised that was true not only of Tennyson. So you feel that you've got the subject for an essay, but you haven't got the subject for a book, though more and more you get books, which of course dilate it. You just think this would have been a good article. It didn't need painstakingly to go through every single instance or to recruit some other poems of which the same thing is true. It should have been left as an essay. I think I'm not answering that at all interestingly, but I'm afraid.
Well, it comes back to something you're talking about, that you're feeling that you were. This surprised me in interviewing George Steiner too, because when I asked him what he felt about his life, he said, well, I suffer from envy. I feel I have lived in the presence of great thinkers and written about them, but I am not I'm a beta plus plus person writing about
as them. High as that?
I'm a beta person. George may be watching this, remember?
I don't mind.
And writing about great people. I was surprised that literary critics had such a low self-esteem.
Well, I think you must be the only person on the planet who thinks that George Steiner suffers from a low self-esteem, but it's very interesting. It is the hope-tipping angle, as advertised by Stephen Potter, you remember. D.H. Lawrence's morbid reluctance to discuss sex, the open sadism of Charles Lamb, and the low self-esteem by George Steiner. It's a wonderful genre you've got, the hope-tipping angle. I have no doubt that what I do is worth doing, and I don't actually doubt that I'm good at it. I don't think I have any kind of genius at all.
But what you're doing is not the most important.
No, it isn't. I think it has become an indispensable service. That is, the fate of literature, unfortunately, is now in the universities. The fate of universities, the fate of literature in previous times has been in the church, or in a political party, or in money, or in money. The patron of the university, the patron of literature is the university. Without the university, there will be no interest in writing by dead people at all. I really believe that. Now, it's not true that only university people care about past literature. It's that there's a point at which the past literature is simply not going to be around, even apart from the education that people get and done. Recency. So it depends what one thinks. What is the crucial patronage without which literature is in terrible trouble? And now it's the universities. So anything bad that happens in universities has an effect which it didn't have when literature had other patrons. It doesn't really have any other patrons now. There are a whole lot of other things in it, aren't there? It depends what one thinks. Well, there's an Arnoldian side to it, in that Arnold seems to me to be a great writer because he knows that what you should do is related to what is at present the case. And since it's not going to be the case in 50 years' time, it's no good saying that the enemy is always, as it were, to this side, not to that side. For Eliot, the great enemy is illusions of feeling. That is, he writes about Stendhal and says that Stendhal's scenes are a positive humiliation to read in their understanding of human feeling and human illusions of feeling. That the world of the newspapers and of everything else is a world which makes people pretend that they feel things that they don't. Maybe it would be good if they did feel those things, but they're never going to feel those things if they believe they already feel them. Newspapers are committed to making you pretend for a while that you care about this, and you don't care about it. It's Beckett, it's Swift, it's Eliot, and so on. But of course, that hasn't always been the case. I mean, we can imagine this. It's not about cynicism, even. It's just that knowing what you actually feel. Eliot says, intelligence, of which an important function is the discernment of exactly what and how much we feel in any given situation. Now, opposition to Steiner would, for me, turn largely on the illusion of feeling. That is, I think that the feelings to which he appeals and which he proclaims are illusory. It might be very good if one had that gigantic concern for this, that, and the other, but it's not realised, I think, in anything that he has written. And the same goes, half of the talks I hear, the congratulations I hear to the students. The students are all wonderful. You mean they're all? No, they're not. What does it mean for somebody to say, it was terrible in China because I heard that the young Chinese students are now behaving exactly like American ones. They tell the people, everybody who was in the Shakespeare plays was told they were wonderful. there were 18 prizes given out afterwards. I think there were only 18 people in it, and everybody got a prize. And I thought, surely, is there a point at which one has to say, we tried very hard at this, but actually it didn't work. Timon of London didn't actually work, if you mean it to be a new angle on Timon of Athens, because you hadn't thought through what it would be to move it from Athens to London. No, do you know what I mean? So it has to do with illusions, or a lot of it does.
Another theme that comes across in certainly some comments I've read on your work, that your kind of criticism is, I forgot what it's called, practical criticism, or kind of criticism opposed to some kinds of postmodern hermeneutic kinds of criticism. Could you explain the schools and what you're opposed to? Just briefly.
Yes. Well, it turns on the relations of philosophy to literature, anciently vexed, mm-hmm. And it then turns on a different form, which is whether Terry Eagleton, as it were, is genuinely a philosopher. So there are partly ancient questions about what the relationship between the arts and philosophy is, which would be not so different from the relationship between the arts and theology, the arts and religion. That is, it's clear that if things are going well, these are complementary and collaborative enterprises, but it's also clear that one is tempted always to claim to be superior to the other. That literature and literary studies are always having to acknowledge the danger of a takeover by history to one side or by philosophy to the other. I take history and philosophy to be the most important constituents of a college of liberal arts and so on. Mm. And history will say this is the case, and philosophy will say this is the truth. Philosophy may say the world is everything which is the case and so on, and that would all be all right. But basically, that literature is in the position of trying to define its responsibilities as, and then we don't quite want the figure of speech of overlapping, but it's in some ways continuous with the claims of history, and in some ways continuous with the claims of philosophy, while still feeling that these have some claims. There is a certain kind of autonomy itself, of troubled concepts. So, for me, Dr. Johnson is the greatest critic because, or it's continuously as being, the most intelligent anti-philosopher in the English language. I mean, he's not just non-philosophical, he's anti-philosophical. The lexicographer is committed to believing that you quite soon reach the point at which further philosophical point is cogitation is not going to be valuable. That is, the lexicographer will tell you the difference between an untruth and a lie, but you quite quickly reach the point at which understanding that more deeply is not a philosophical question, it's a historical question, a political question, a theological question, and so on. So the cast of mind is not just kicking the stone and I refute it thus, and so on. So I do think, now Aristotle was, of course, a philosopher, so he's not one not going to deny, but the poetics, we have less of his art criticism, so on. So that's an ancient contested thing, and Leavis versus Wellek is the really important case of it. Wellek is not, of course, a philosopher, he's a philosophically inclined historian of literature and theorist of literature. So what happens then with the arrival of French theory, or something like that? What characterizes a philosophy? It has to be more fully articulated, it has to be more cogently concatenated, it has to claim to cover the whole lot, and so on. And it's the opposite cast of mind from that which thinks that principles are again and again like proverbs, that is, that the difficult thing is not, there isn't a philosophical question about he who hesitates is lost versus look before you leap. Mm. But the understanding of the difference between them, and understanding why we don't have a proverb that says don't look before you leap, or he who hesitates is saved, which is the implication. So it is a different cast of mind, and I think it is much truer to how writers have written of their work, and I think it's much truer to the achievement that is War and Peace, or the achievement that's King Lear, and so on. for Leavis, it would have to do with scientism, but it isn't actually the physical sciences that have turned out to be kind of an enemy from within. That is, it's a resistance to sciences. It says we've got to look as if we're not a soft option. We know we're not a soft option, but that's not understood. So what we will have is technical terms without which the general public is not impressed. If literature, Christopher Hillary's take, literature is what historians read in bed, and so on. And of course he's very, very well read and writes wonderfully about Richardson and about Marvel and so on, and about Milton. But so that's something like that. It's part of an age-old story. The Cambridge quarrel was a quarrel, was presented as a quarrel about postmodernist theory. I don't believe that it was. I think it was about the claims of a particular person called Colin McCabe. And particularly the claim that he should be promoted to a lectureship without entering into open competition with other candidates for such a lectureship.
Just hearing you talk, there seems to be one possible thread through your work, which is basically a sort of kind of knight rescuer of damsels in distress kind of theme, which is basically the people you've written to the aid of have either been attacked seriously, like Milton, by later critics, or ignored, like Tennyson, or forgotten, like Eliot, by Geoffrey Hill. So it seems to be a matter of bringing back into discussion and attention people who, for one reason or not, are not properly appreciated. Do you think that's reasonable interpretation?
Yes, I suppose that whenever anybody says anything, it's either to supply and substantiate an opinion where there wasn't one at all previously, or to amend an existing opinion when there is one. That is, you could think that there isn't at present out there any account of Christina Rossetti that needs to be contested as potent and mischievous. That is, so why is one speaking at all? Presumably one would like to think that one has noticed something that other people haven't noticed. Or if I were to be very rudimentary about it, I would say the scholar makes the claim that he or she knows something which you may well not know. He or she better not suppose that you don't know it. There are questions of tact. Actually, I didn't know that. And the critic supposes that he or she may well have noticed something you hadn't noticed. They're complementary activities, but they are very, very different. And the critic needs to acknowledge that there are the kinds of facts that he would need to know about a poem, not necessarily a poem by Pope. So I suppose one is saying something in order either to supply or to contest, either supply an opinion or to contest an opinion. I don't see any other reason for saying anything at all. Everything is a yes, but. I mean, Leavis used, it's a wonderful formula by Leavis. He himself was prone to have the yes be about this big and the but be about that big, but that's not in itself necessarily objectionable. I mean, he has warm and authentic praise for Tennyson, but he thinks that Tennyson's weaknesses are not only bad for Tennyson, but bad for all poetry that supposed that Tennyson didn't have those weaknesses and so on. And of course he makes a great many concessions about Hopkins. I mean, the contrast with Hopkins. Hopkins is strong in these respects, but he did pay a huge price for isolation. He did pay and so on. So it's all a yes, but. Or, in a variant of that, I try to tell my students in America and told them in England, one question is this true? That is, of such and such a remark about why Keats' poem moves us, is this true? Another is, what truth is there in this? Which is a very different question. We need both of those questions. We need not to think they're the same question. In America, getting students to ask the question, what truth is there in this, is itself very difficult. Because the move very quickly to a vote, verdict, and sentence is that we're all busy, we're in a hurry. And so on, so sort of, is this any good or not? Is this true or isn't it true? Well, what truth is there in the idea that so and so and so and so? So some of that, I mean, one of my convictions is that art exists to give us pause. There are many, many other things that art exists to do, but being given pause would be particularly valuable just now, where everybody can spare you a microsecond of attention, where even the President of the United States of America is cut off in mid-sentence because of what a sound bite is and so on. So our sick hurry, our divided aims, so everything is against some sort of background of what the prevailing danger and threat is. To resist the age whenever it becomes tyrannous. Now, nobody in America, what they want to do is find out what the age is doing and go along with it. That is what you've got to do. If nobody is reading any longer, give up reading. If everybody now is committed to only texting or and so on. So I think, yes, it's true that there has to be something that one believes either needs to be said. There isn't an opinion out there about the poems of James Henry. Mm. That is, I edited the poems of James Henry because nobody reads James Henry's poems. His poems are disparaged in the entry on him in the Oxford Dictionary of National Biography or in the old DNB because he is thought to be a highly eccentric classical scholar. But I think him a very fine poet. I edited him purely by fluke in that I was struck by the names James Henry and not being Henry James. I took down from the Cambridge University Library a copy of his poems and found that he had presented them, privately printed in Dresden in the 1850s and 60s, presented them to this library as to Harvard and Oxford, and the pages had never been cut. And there was a kind of Henry Jamesian pathos about that for me and so on. So here I'm simply wanting to give people some poems. By what mistake were pigeons made so happy? That's a wonderful opening line for a poem. It's an extraordinary vision of life and so on. And I think him a really extraordinary, he's a minor poet of real powers and so on a lifelong anti-Christian crusade. And a great classical scholar. So that, but if I write about Eliot, it's because I think that there is a potent and mischievous belief that pretty well everything in Eliot is vitiated by his misogyny and anti-Semitism. I don't believe he was a misogynist, and I do believe that on occasion his poems, as he on occasion in his life, were misogynistic. But I try to set that within a context of making it clear how difficult it is to talk about prejudice unprejudicially, etc. And so it's true that one's got to be supplying or contesting. I don't know what else one could be doing, really. Everything is revisionist. Mm. I mean, if you talk about revisionist history, what is non-revisionist history? I mean, it feels it's like people talking about a heuristic probe. What is a non-heuristic probe, since heuristic means proby or probing? So that seemed to me the position, and it is of course the position of a lot of art.
Mm.
April is the cruelest month, which is either saying April and not, as you might have thought, November is the cruelest month, or April is the cruelest and not, as you might have thought, the tenderest month. It's contesting something, as every poem or every work of art in a way contests something.
Mm.
It might contest vacuity. That is that there are a lot of writers about whom there isn't really a valuable appreciative force out there.
Mm.
I mean, nobody has had an idea about Charles Doughty for nearly 100 years. It's not so. If you're going to write about Doughty, what you've got to do is create or justify the belief. You've got to make good. You have to give up the belief that you can prove, and you have to hold to the belief that you can make good. And in a world which thinks that if you cannot prove it, all you have is an opinion, all you have is something subjective, you resist the subjective-objective and antithesis. You say with Empson, I will not use those words except when quoting somebody else, that something terrible happened when the human race or the English language agreed that was it. There are only two possibilities, it's subjective or it's objective. You try intersubjective. That won't work for various reasons. The meaning of a word is not a subjective opinion or an objective fact. It's a body of agreements built up over a very, very long period. So the belief that there are things of which can be proved is essential, and there are belief that things are the greatest value which cannot be proved, but don't leave us with anarchy and caprice and whim, I can give reasons for thinking that this is an unjust accusation against Eliot. That the line, female smells in shuttered rooms, if you believe it's misogynistic, it's because you yourself have yielded to misogyny. The word smells is entirely neutral in the matter. Do you know what I mean? It's not odours confected by the cunning French disguise the good old hearty female stench, which is unquestionably trading in misogyny. It might be trading it and characterising it, dramatising it. The answer is it isn't, actually. But there's a whole argument there. So I do think these matters of how you make good, how you do, Dr. Johnson is right on this, as on almost everything. You are trying to improve opinion into knowledge. And that itself was a revision of elevate opinion to knowledge. He published it as that, and then later he revised it. The word elevate is not right. It has an illusion of feeling in it. You're not going to elevate it, you're going to improve it. And you're not going to elevate it to, you're going to improve it into. And it's knowledge, it's not truth, it's not fact, but it is knowledge. The great things in Leavis seem to me to be, it's an accession of knowledge. That when you step across the line, I happened to be reading it yesterday or this morning, and sometimes like a gleaner, thou dost keep steady thy laden head across a brook. And he simply says that the step across from the one line to the next, and sometimes like a gleaner, thou dost keep steady thy laden head, but the internal rhyme is wonderful as it settles itself in the second line, that something, you are enacting and feeling something, and you feel what it is as a gleaner with the things on your head in autumn when it might very well be slippery to step across the brook. And it's a wonderful, it's wonderfully experiential, without being a clever corporeal mimicry. I think these things are, I do feel very, very grateful for the critic who explains to me why and how that has worked upon me, while not thinking that that activity of explaining it is of the same order as Keats's doing it. I'm grateful as I'm, it's not exactly a smaller gratitude. It's a gratitude different in kind. Something like that.
I've got one other question I may be able to get in, but
please.
When you were in the army, it lit out just as you were being sent off on some mission. They would turn to you and say, "Are there any questions you would like answered first?" So, inversion of this in some way. Is there anything else you'd really like to say? Because this will be seen by a lot of people, possibly. Are there any other principles of your life or your work that you'd like to add? Doesn't matter if you do, but.
I don't know that there are. I think the case for principles in itself is something. I was lecturing in China just now. I was to give the first talk, not out of any grandeur. And perhaps it was signaled that they were ringing somebody, but I wasn't any of anybody. It was clear to me that the first talk ought to cover a whole range of things and not be what I most like doing, which is, as it were, saying, here is how Hardy originally had his stanza rhyme scheme go, and here is how he revised it. Now, I love that sort of thing, but it seemed to me you couldn't quite kick off with that. It was a 4 or 5 day conference. You've got to have something which might touch more things. So I did talk about principles, and it was important to me to think, as with Eliot, that these are principles which have their application not only in literature but elsewhere. So that the great statements of principle, Benjamin Disraeli saying that next to knowing when to seize an opportunity, the most important thing in life is knowing when to forego an advantage. Now, I think it's not a philosophy, it is not a theory, it is open immediately to the acknowledgement there will be a great many cases when that isn't, and so on. But it's a wonderful, I think, it's a formulation which is not formulaic at all. It's a very, very, very extraordinary. The way to get things done is not to care who gets the credit for doing them. Now, these seem to be very profound statements of principle, exactly because they're representative but not universalizable. So they're trying to find something which is not simply the single instance, nor the universal insistence, and so on. I think it's a great thing to be able to do. And the corollary of that, I terrifically regret the way in which the notion of tolerance has been evacuated so that in America it now means not disapproving. Whereas I think tolerance requires disapproval in order to be tolerance. That is, to tolerate something is to disapprove of it, but not to realize one's disapproval in any of the unjust, dishonorable, bad ways. That is, I speak against this, I do not, as it were, deny the person tenure. I this and this and so on. So tolerance in America now means not disapproving, and we have lost a very, very important social concept, which for me is not a, I don't need a philosophy of tolerance, though I believe that philosophers can give one, or, you know, can feel an obligation. I need to be very clear what the principle of tolerance is. It's not that I would do nothing to try and oppose what you stand for. I will oppose it, but I will not oppose it in the ways that can fairly be described as intolerance of it, and so on. So the world that we're in, so it has to do with, it's sort of, there's a kind of gestalt thing. It has to do with, what is this up against? Go back to my mother's midwife. It's up against, what is the background against which this remark is to be understood at all? Every letter in the Boston Globe believes that there is nothing to be said for anything other than the position that it adopts, and that no price is paid for that position. I'm working on the great Victorian judge and public figure controversialist James Fitzjames Stephen. I'm the co-editor of an 11-volume edition of his works. I will edit the volume on the novel and journalism. And Stephen, to me, is astonishing in that he will say, here is somebody who fled the field of battle. You didn't execute him at the time. What should you now do? Should you, as A and B have said, deport him to Australia? Should you, and so on? And Stephen says, you should do such and such, but there are real disadvantages of that. If you do that, you will gain A, B, C, D, E, but be perfectly clear, you will lose F, G, and H. And he's very, very clear about, and it's completely against the spirit of the age. The spirit of the age says, if we do this, we gain everything, we lose nothing. It's how politics talks, it's how people talk about the universities, and just anything like that now. So again, perhaps that goes back to the thought of being given pause. And it's clear that there are moments in history or moments in one's individual life when the last thing one needs to be given is pause. Excuse me, you've prevaricated about this matter. Thank you very much.